Hey guys, World Eater here. Today we are going to try to get through tier 6, and we're going to try to see if we can get through Morgoroth. Right now I am rocking full tier 6 epics. So we're going to see if we can get through with just tier 6 epics. Let's go ahead and start off on the first flag. The first flag is going to be clear the dungeon of all enemies. We're going to have Borland in the middle as usual, just for safety reasons. And yeah, let's go ahead and get to it. Alright, so these are two new enemies, closest and deals damage to all. Their speed is fairly low, but it will be hitting everybody. So far it seems like Borland is safe in the back. Let's check this guy out. Closest, random, spread heal, but he does have a high speed. So we will be wanting to get rid of the guy in the back, because usually when it's deals random, it does a lot of damage regardless, due to the fact that it's random. So let's go ahead and try to get through this real quick. See if we can kill these guys. All right, let's see if I can auto this. All right, it seems autoable. So I'm going to go ahead and see if there's any other new familiars. If not, then we will be going to fast forward to the end of this. Yeah, it seems like it's just going to be these two fams. So I'll see you at the loot recap screen. Alright, seems like all we got was a rare and some commons with some XP. Let's go ahead and go on through. Okay. Now, since I am about to level, I'm going to go ahead and convert one of my energy, or 100 of my energy into shards, just because I'm about to level up. Okay, we unlocked the second flag, clear dungeon of all enemies again. Go ahead and enter, and we're going to keep the same format for now. And here is a newer enemy type. He is closest, target teammate, and weakest. So regardless, Borland is not safe, but again, he is safest in the back for now. So let's just keep him in the back. I'm going to see if I can auto this. All right, Borland is getting a little weak there, just by those hits. So if they keep hitting him with weakest, then it could be problematic. We might have to swap him out for another Shramps, but for now he seems fine. I'm gonna go ahead and auto on through this, and I'll see you at the loot recap screen. All right. We just got a bunch of commons again and some XPs. Let's go ahead and proceed on by. Okay. Now for the third flag. It's going to be End the Marvin Wingo Alliance. So it seems like there's going to be two mini bosses, which might be problematic. I remember Wingo was the one that hit weakest, so that's pretty scary. We'll try it with the layout we have now. Putting Borland in back, of course. And if this doesn't work, we will have to put another Shrimps in the back and keep us in the middle. But let's try this out. Okay. Now, just for optimization, you would want to target out the Wingo in the back, because he does have 2-1 SPs. Both of them will pretty much keep sustain or attack your Borland. So what you're going to want to do is target him if you are having problems with this. But if you're not, then just auto on by like I have. But again, he is the biggest problem. So if you are having issues, like let's say you don't have enough epics, like you're lacking a little bit of total stats, then you can pretty much just attack the back, because that's usually where he seems to hang out. But for now, it's okay to just auto on through if you have all the epics. If you don't have the epics, again, you can hold on to your tier 5 epics and replace whatever wasn't tier 5 epics. Like, let's say you had some tier 5 commons. You can always replace those with tier 6 commons, and you might have enough total stats. But I always do recommend at the beginning of the game to max out on all of your epics once you pass tier 4, I believe. That's when you need to start having max epics if you want to just smooth on by everything, which is pretty easy. I'd say about 2 to 4 days of regen only should get you everything you need, which is good. Okay, here's Wingo. My name is Wingo. Isn't that just neato? Look at my robe. It has no sleevos. What robe has no sleeves? That's so weird. Okay, so again, he is hitting Borland pretty bad. What you want to do is target the back line. I'm going to go ahead and heal Borland. I don't have to, really, but I'm going to. Target the back line. You want to keep that sustain up. It seems like everything's good, though. He does hit pretty hard, so you got to pretty much kill him before he's able to pop off that one SP. All right, so again, we just have some rares and commons, some XPs. And we are about to level up pretty soon, which is pretty awesome. Now, we are going to the first dungeon of Morgoroth. Again, as long as you have carries, pretty easy. I have some carries here, so I'm just going to go ahead and auto on through. And I'll stop at the boss, so I'll see you there. Rugums, you want to know how I got these rolls? Well, it's probably because I eat everyone who enters my sewer. So many rolls. I couldn't even check him out. I'll show you his moveset when we get to town. He died like instantly, unfortunately. Okay, so we got a common familiar, which is this guy, Drogons. He's pretty cool. Drogons, did we check him out yet? I don't think we have. Oh, yes, we have. His skills were the attack. All right, yeah. Okay. I just forgot to say his name. Oh, well. So we're going to go to familiars real quick. After that, we will continue the flags. Now, this was for Rugums, which is this guy? Yes. Okay. So his skills was closest enemy, target enemy, and spread. So since he has a 1 SP target enemy, he is problematic. The good thing is he has very little speed for his stat distribution, so he shouldn't be too much of a problem. He seems more like a tank. His damage is pretty weak as well. You don't really have to worry about taking him out first unless he is boosted. By boosted, I mean usually like if he's a boss, and if he's a boss, I mean obviously you're going to have to take him out, but what I recommend doing is taking out whatever sustains him by healing him. So pretty much any of the healing fams that were in the dungeon, take them out first. And any of the attack weakest fams you want to take out as well. Okay, Oppo's Marsh. Find and defeat King Oppo. Okay, now this is good. Oppo is a familiar that we are going to have to be farming consistently. So once we get to the dungeon at the end of these three flags, it is going to be one of the main farms that you are going to be farming for quite a while. Let's say you don't have enough total stats to continue on through the flags in the next tier or this tier or whatever, but you have this dungeon pretty much ready. You're going to want to always come back to this dungeon until you finish making a certain familiar. So for right now, we're going to put Borland in the middle, me in the back, and Shramps up front. Okay, so here is Oppo. Oppo is closest to, and random. So there's no real saving Borland unless you get lucky with the random and not get him hit by it. So you're going to want him in the back only because they do have a closest to attack. So the random enemy is problematic, but it's fine. We're going to go ahead and see if we can auto on through this. It seems pretty easy. We seem to have plenty of total stats. Okay. All right, it seems like we can do this. I will see you at the end of the dungeon at the loot cap screen. Om chom, weeup, om chom, weeup, om chom chom. Alright, so he's pretty much just a boosted version of the other one, so he will be attacking closest to. He is pretty strong, so you more than likely will have to manual this. I really recommend you just keep healing and just attacking whenever you can. Heal whenever you can attack, of course attack, but you want to prioritize healing, because as you can see, Shramps is taking quite the beating. I'm going to heal him back to full there, or as close to full as possible. Okay, we should be able to do this. Oh yeah, we got this. There you go. Okay, that wasn't too bad. But again, I do have maxed out tier 6 epics. He might be a problem for you guys if you guys aren't maxed out tier 6 epics. As you can see here, I'll show you again, maxed out tier 6 epics. Now, I'm pretty sure you've noticed, but I have been focusing all of my points in strength. In my opinion, no matter what role you play, it's always safe to put all of your points into strength. Even if you are a tank, you can more than likely get to the tanked health numbers that you want with just pretty much setting these at whatever you want them to be. Like if you want to focus health, put it in vitality. That's pretty much an easy way to obtain the health numbers you want later on if you do become a tank. But regardless, you always want to put it into damage, in my opinion, unless you're really trying to min-max a certain build for DPS, and you might want to put some speed in. Some people put speed. Some people like to put health. I really think it's kind of pointless to put health. I usually put it in damage, because damage is always useful no matter what. Like, in every scenario, more damage will always help. So, I always put it into damage. I highly recommend you always put it into damage. That's my take on that. You could follow it, or you could put in whatever you want, but for sure, at the beginning of the game, more damage is best. Okay, let's see what I got here. Make sure you always claim your bounties, because as you can see here, you get gems, you get mount guts. Mount guts are pretty annoying. The gems and mount guts are pretty much what you want to aim for. So we now are at the fifth flag, the second for this area right here. Stumpy's Badlands. Find and defeat King Stumpy. So it's going to be another mini boss. We're going to keep Borland in the middle because we don't know what Stumpy does. Alright, here's Stumpy. Stumpy is closest and heals teammates. He has very low stamina, but he is a glass cannon. He hits pretty hard, so let's see if we can auto on through this. He does closest, so I'm going to put myself in the middle, since just in case Shramps gets nuked, I'll be next and Borland will be safe. It seems like we can auto this. I'm going to go ahead and see you all at the loot crap screen. My music is the grandest in all the land. I've been called the flute bird of my generation by people who have heard me flute. That's so random. Okay, so again, he is closest and heals teammate. Your Shramps is going to get nuked. And yeah, the good thing is he heals teammates, which means it usually means that it's a small spread. So let's go ahead and manual this, because he is going to be nuking our Shramps pretty hard. And just keep putting on damage and healing up Shramps. Okay. Ah, pretty easy, honestly. That wasn't too bad at all. Okay, so we got a bunch of commons. Some XPs. Awesome. We are now at the sixth flag, which is the third for this small area. Chewy's Channel. Find and defeat King Chewy. Chewy is going to be a rare fam, so he might be a little harder. Keeping Borland in the middle is the safest option, so we're going to keep him there for now. Here is Chewy. Let's check him out. We got closest enemy, weakest enemy, which is a problem, and closest enemy. So Borland will be safest in the back. So since he does have weakest enemy and a lot of speed with a lot of damage, he is going to be doing chomp quite a bit with the weakest enemy. So if you see him, you're going to want to take him out first, more than likely. By the looks of it, I don't think I can auto. I am going to manual this dungeon, only because it seems like Borland is going to be struggling. If I do not pass this, and I recommend if you guys don't pass this, to try having two Shramps instead of having a Borland and Shramps, and seeing if that helps you progress faster. But yes, due to the fact that there is a lot of weakest attacks, I will have to be doing the manual run. That way I can keep healing my Borland up to full. It's better to take one out than to do them all, like damage all of them at once. So we're going to be trying to take out the front one as fast as possible each time. So if you have an attack all like this one right here, or attack team, or closest to, if it does less damage than the front one, I recommend you just do closest, or whatever does the most damage that can pretty much one shot, that'll be your best option. Whatever can get rid of one of them the fastest is always going to be your best option in that scenario. Now we have a health shrine, don't know if we'll need it. I'll more than likely save it until I come up to King Chu himself, but as of right now it seems to be going quite well. Sustain is key. Usually after you defeat one or two of them, you can keep up with your sustain quite well. Okay, let's heal up a little bit. There you go. We're not topped off, but we're pretty close. Now, every time you go in a dungeon like this, you want to inch forward to make sure you don't run into the boss himself, since there is going to be problems with this one, I'm pretty sure. I did a damage all just because I was hoping to hit a crit on one of them, since I do have a target right here, but I didn't really hit too hard of a crit. I'm gonna try it again. Okay. As you see here, I'm pretty low. It's because I let more of them stay alive. Here I can do an attack all and I might be able to take two out, so I'm gonna do it. Excellent. Now let's keep, awesome. I got a really good empowered crit there. So let's go ahead and proceed on through. We have plenty of health now. I was getting a little worried there. Ooh, some gold. Okay, this is a very long path. Let's go ahead and heal up. Damage closest, closest, closest. Closest, heal. I'm gonna use my mount skill. Closest, heal, closest, heal, closest, closest, heal, closest, closest. Whoops, I didn't mean to do that one, but that's fine. Okay, so he is here. I am going to go back and I'm going to get this health shrine. Let me see if there's any more chews. I don't think there is. No, it doesn't seem like it. So I'm going to get the health shrine and then I'm going to auto to him. Okay. Chomp, 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 chomp. So this guy, again, let's check him out. He has a weakest. And as you can see, the last guys were hitting Borland pretty hard, and since he is a mini boss form of his rare self, he will be hitting pretty hard. He might even one-shot her Borland, which is why I'm saying if you cannot pass this, you might want to have two Shramps. But let's check it out. He is taking significantly less damage than I was hoping he would. So your best attack would be the target if you have a sword like myself. Let's go ahead and heal him up. Okay, so we gotta be careful here. Heal. For Shramps, I'm just gonna do damage since his heal is very insignificant, and I'm going to be healing only with Borland unless I don't have the SP, just so we can hit this guy a little harder. I'm going to swap out since Shramps is looking pretty low. Let's go ahead and heal. I'm gonna come back since I'm looking pretty low now. Okay, so my guy seems to have died. It's pretty bad to get there, but we're going to try a minor revive potion. This attack does 365 to 547. Yes, so we're gonna be doing slam, heal, closest. Oh, I'm dead, but it seems like we finished this, so we're fine. So if you do die, as long as you're able to finish it off, everything's fine. But yeah, that was pretty close. So it seems like you might have to have all tier 6 epics just to beat this guy. Hopefully that's not the case. Again, I only have a rare mount. You can't see it here in the recap screen, but I only have a maxed out rare mount. If you have a maxed out legendary, or I believe even the 3-tiered legendary, you will be doing a lot better. If you have a maxed out epic, you will definitely be doing better. But I do have only a maxed out rare. And yeah, so pretty much it's all about total stats here. Loot doesn't really matter right now, so there's no set bonuses or nothing. You're gonna want to just have more total stats, so the higher the better. But again, legendaries are harder to do. I have a legendary here just in case, but I don't have what I need to upgrade it yet. It was more of a just in case I needed it thing. Nothing really necessary, but as of right now I am using all epics, which I got from the raid. I got a lot of epics from this raid and it was awesome. My first run on a Saturday buff was pretty much 3 of the epics I needed, which was awesome, and I was just on commons, which was all green boosts, so that's not too bad. We are now in the second dungeon, Uzumire. Uzumire is a great place to farm. Trust me, Blem is used for a lot of familiars, and it also has Omo, I believe? Omo? One of the two. And pretty much you're going to use that Oppo fam. Let me see if the schematics here, if I can click out of this. No, he is not, but that is fine. I believe you can only get it in World Boss. Okay, again, I do have carry, so I'm just going to auto on through, and I will see you at the loot recap screen or when we get to the boss. Again, before I go, you are going to want to get as many Oppos as possible, so try to make sure you get Oppos. Do not bribe them, just persuade them, of course. He's ugly. Ooh, tiny little small itty bitty snack. He is ugly. Okay, he does closest, furthest, all enemies, so he's pretty annoying. He has the whole ground covered since he has all enemies and furthest. The safest would be the middle, of course, since the most damage he can do to the middle is 237 to 289 compared to pretty much almost 800 damage. The furthest is going to be the most dangerous, but it has a 1 SP requirement and his speed is pretty low, so again, your tank is still safest in the front. And this guy has closest to yourself. Closest and to yourself. So that means usually if you do a damage to yourself in one of the abilities, it usually means you're going to be doing a hefty amount of damage, which he is doing here. That's a pretty good amount of damage compared to any of these other attacks. But again, it is a 2 SP, so there's really nothing to worry about. Let's go ahead and auto on through it. Okay, again, loot recap, just some comments. Let's go to town. All right, so here it's cleared the dungeon of all enemies again. We're gonna have Borla in the middle for safety, and let's go ahead and see who we're gonna be fighting in this dungeon. Ooh, okay, this is gonna be the Eulerius area. Eulerius is gonna be a very, very necessary fam for the next area. So you're going to need a bunch of these guys. I highly recommend you capture all of these guys. You're gonna need them all. This one is Negrim, which is closest enemy, closest into yourself, which means it's gonna hit pretty hard. That 260 to 787 is devastating. That could be really good or really bad for him. Deals damage to the closest two. So that closest two, although he does have low speed, automatically puts Borla in the back. Depending on what Larzul does, he's closest, target, and here's the scary part. He has the most speed out of any fam so far and furthest. So pretty much, it's still pretty dangerous to have Borland second, but he is going to be safer there only because this guy in back is very fast and hits furthest with the 2 SP. You're going to want to target him out no matter what. Let's go ahead and see if we can auto this. If not, your main focus so far in this first flag is going to be Larzul. Let's go ahead and check it out. Alright, for the loot recap, it seems like we just got a bunch of commons. That was a pretty easy flag. Let's go ahead and see what's next. Again, I do recommend doing all these stars when you can. It is best to get the max bonus, especially if you are hunting familiars. It would always be the best option. So clear dungeon of all enemies. Usually the second flag, if it's the same as the first, it will be introducing a new enemy. We are going to see who is new. And it seems to be this guy. Okay. Oh, wow. Varlos. Closest. Damage to all. And he has high speed. And target. So he is immediately going to be who you want to single out when you see him in a group. That target and damage all is going to be devastating, especially since it does quite a hefty amount of damage. So we're going to see if we can auto through this. The safest spot will be the back for him, but whenever you do have the other familiars, it will still be the second spot. So I'm going to see if I can auto through this. If you are having problems, you might want to swap out your Borland for another Shramps to see if that will work. But as of right now, everything seems good. Okay, since he is going to have this attack for this guy here, we are going to put Borland back in the middle. Let's go ahead and see if we can auto this. It doesn't seem like we can, so I'm going to physically take over. The damage to all enemies is good, but again, you will want to be taking out as many of them as possible. Since this guy in the back is already pretty weak, I'm going to take him out. Heal. The less enemies, the easier it will be to self-sustain yourself. So let's keep attacking them. And now that there's only one, we should be able to top ourselves off a little bit here. I'm going to save my mount skill just in case I really need it later. The less potions you lose, the better. So I'm going to manual this whole dungeon. It's pretty challenging so far, even with max epics. I believe this is only the second one so far, so this isn't even the hardest dungeon so far, or the hardest flag. Let's target out the guy in back, since I believe he will heal them. There you go, we got a pretty good shot there. Let's take out the guy in the front. Heal. I will do attack all. Oop, didn't kill him, but that's fine. Okay. Closest, heal. Closest. Closest. Heal. Heal. Closest, closest. Oh my. I'm going to want to get a heal off before I can't heal next time. I don't want to have these potions. So the mount skill was necessary there. Now, if you don't have a mount skill, you probably would want to just keep going. Like if your mount skill was a damaging attack, you would probably want to keep going versus using a potion and hoping that you had another turn to heal your Borland if you're feeling risky. But if you're very low on revive potions, then you would want to heal them right then and there. It looks like there's a health shrine right here, which is unfortunate since I already did use my mount scale, but that is fine. You want to target the back line since he is pretty one-shottable in this dungeon. You're going to target the front now. I'm going to target front versus healing, and then I'm going to heal. Save some SPs for when we need it the most. There you go. Heal again. Heal just to top off. And there you go. Seems like everything's going pretty swell. I don't believe we need this right now. We're gonna save it. There is still one more guy at the bottom. Let's target the guy in the back right now. As long as you get rid of him, see, it's pretty much one free familiar to get rid of. As long as you save one SP if you're using a sword or something that has a high damage output, like how this has around 700-ish to 1,000, that hits pretty hard. So just keep using that attack when possible. Wow, Borland was pretty much a one-shot. I'm going to do attack team so we can do a little bit of chip damage to the guys in the back. I'm going to do attack target and attack the closest. Got to make sure you're always healing with Borland when possible just to keep yourself sustained. I'm going to save some SP. Nice. Okay. So there should be one more familiar, so I am going to be hitting the shrine. Now let's go fight him. Again, target the back line when possible. He should be one shot, and then closest after that. The only time you will be doing an attack team is if you know your familiar is about that you can pretty much take out the enemy teammate and pretty much do some chip damage at the same time. So you don't really have to worry about using attack team if you have it. You're only going to use it if you know you can kill whoever's in front or whoever's in back or whatever and get some chip damage on someone else. You only want to use the attack team if it's a killing blow for that flag. Find and defeat Larzul Lord. The Larzul Lord. Shadow Tunnels. It's going to be a mini boss. It's going to be a little hard. The last flag was pretty hard. Larzul, I believe, is the one with the sword, which is the one that hits pretty hard. Borland is safest in the middle, so let's keep him there. It seems like we are going to need a Borland, though. I don't know if we can do this with two Shramps, so hopefully we have enough total stats to do this. So far, we're doing this all in one run. Again, the best thing to do here is target the backline. We are still pretty good. I'm not going to use heals yet. Pop him off in the back. Heal now, since everyone was a little weak. Now, you're going to want to target the sword guy next. You don't want to damage Negrim at all. Negrim is pretty safe to fight. You're going to be building SP on him, and then you're going to try to target the backline. The backline, again, is the worst to go against. Usually, it's always tank in front, and then the more important ones in the back. Okay. So, this guy right here, we definitely have to take him out. Okay, so this is going to be pretty easy. Just boom. Heal up, heal up. And target. Nice. So, we can just keep healing up here. Top ourselves off, save some SP, and just spam your one now. You always want to save up some SP. You never know when you're going to need it. Okay, so far this is going pretty good. Since we are going to have a mini boss here and it does seem kind of challenging, you will want to save as much SP as possible. So for Shramps, I'm not going to be using any SP attacks at all. For Borland, I'm just going to heal when I have to. But for now, since there is a lot of Negrims, that's a good thing. Negrim's pretty easy to go against. And since I have a healing brain when I get hit, I could self-sustain most of it. I might not even have to heal. Let's check this out. Since he is looking a little weak, I will pump one heal or two heals into him. And then I will just keep going normally. Alright. Still pretty good. Okay. This is a sword guy. Okay, so you're going to want to target the back line here still. I'm going to heal. I'm going to save the SP though. I'm going to target the very back. Heal again, heal, target the back, and then I'm going to try to just one SP if possible. I'm going to pop off one heal. Looks like we might have to do another heal. Okay, that looks good. Just one SP. Okay. So we have quite a bit of SP here, which is pretty good. So we're going to go ahead and go on by. Let's get this chest first. Ooh, another chest right next to the other one. That's pretty rare. Okay. Bunch of trash, but that's fine. I love seeing Negrim. When I see Negrim, I know it's good. Oh, okay. It's not a sword guy. That's good. If it was a sword guy, I'd be terrified. So I'm going to make sure I'm definitely topped off here. So what you're going to want to do is backline, and target. And then you're just going to want to heal up and save SP as much as possible. SP is important here. Heals, though, are way more important. You want to make sure you're healed up. We have plenty of SP, and we have good health. I think we're pretty much topped off here. We're just about. Shramps has very little missing. We have one SP for each. They should be able to build to two once we get to this guy. Larzul is going to be the last guy here. Your death will be by my hand. So he's pretty weak, which is awesome. You're going to want to just pretty much target the back line, like I said before. Wow, he has a lot of health in comparison. Just keep nuking the back end. Hopefully we can take him out. He is pretty tanky, surprisingly, with the amount of speed he has. So we're going to want to heal up. I might have to use my mount skill on him. It seems like I'm going to have to use my mount skill. I'm going to use my mount skill if I want Shramps to die. Now, the problem with this guy in the back is he has a heals target teammate. I don't know if heals target teammate can heal yourself or not, but if it can, that's pretty problematic. Okay, it seems like we're barely sustaining enough. Now, this is looking bad. We're going to put me up front, and we're going to put Borland in back because he has an attack furthest. Yeah, make sure that this guy, Shrimps, gets back up to health. I don't want to use any potions on him if I don't have to. Okay, so put Shrimps back up front. Put me in the back. And we're going to heal Shrimps. And heal me. Target. Heal. Our SP's pretty low here. Heal. Target. Closest. We're going to save as much with Shrimps as possible SP-wise so we can do another attack for this. Since his heal is pretty insignificant, like I said before, we are going to be needing those attack for this. So Shrimps has already used his potion. If we lose Shrimps, that's going to be very bad for us. We're going to put me in the front for now. Put Borland in the back. Pop that heal off. Target the back end. Okay. We're going to put Shrimp. Actually, we're going to put Borland up front. Shrimps in the back. And me in the middle. Heal. Attack the back end. Front. Front. Okay. So here's the problem. I don't really recommend using any major revive potions, but I'm going to use it this one time because I might be able to actually beat this dungeon. So target the back end. Front. Okay, it's looking very bad. It's very scary right now. Okay, this is the worst case scenario. We have lost our tank, so we have to take him out as fast as possible. The good thing is all of the heals are going to be going to my character now, so there's no stat spread there. Let's heal up. Target the back line. Closest. Yeah. Dang. Okay, we were pretty close there. So we're going to try to rerun that again. I think we can actually do it, but it's looking pretty risky right now. Let's go ahead and try doing... I'm going to try putting some... No, because I do need my one-shot potential since he is pretty strong. Do I have the axe? I believe I saved an axe. Let me see. Let's go to main hands. I did. Okay, I saved another tier 6 epic main hand. We could try that out. The problem with this one is it's not going to be focused on one stat, and it is going to give me more speed, which I don't like using speed at this point in the game, but I'm going to see the, I guess the weapon skills real quick. I should have probably checked that before leveling it. Closest, drain health, so that's some good sustain. Closest, target enemy, does a lot of damage, but the problem with this is it's a 2 SP. So I'm not sure how we're going to do this. Maybe the best thing to do would be to take out the first two guys. So let's go ahead and try that out. I'm going to see how this axe treats me. Let's try this one more time. Borland was safest in the middle by the looks of it. Okay. Again, I'm going to manual this so I can make sure that I save up enough SPs. So the guy in the back will always be the main focus. Okay. See, now with this axe, I don't have an attack furthest, which is the problem. So I'm not sure how this is going to treat me. Let's try putting me in front for this one, actually. Let's see how that treats me since I do have a drain all attack. Okay. Back end is the riskiest part, so I'm going to drain all, back end, heal, closest. Heal, drain all, closest. Yeah, it seems like we are going to be needing that sword for sure. This axe is just not cutting it. It's actually looking pretty dangerous for us right here. Okay, good thing is we were able to get through this, but the axe is not cutting it at all. Let's go ahead and swap back to the sword. Okay. Now here we're going to want to put our shrimps back up front and me in the back. We're going to target the back line. Heal up so we can get back to full. As you can see, the sword is a lot more consistent since you can target out the back line. This is why you want to keep your main hand as an epic at all times, until you actually need the full amount of stats from the legendaries. That way you can swap out things and try it out. You never know when something will help you out. So right now we're going to keep saving SP. We're going to want to make sure that our Borlin and Shrimps get as much SP as possible. Okay. Save SP. I'll just target him with my main character. He evaded it. That's surprising. Okay. I'm going to heal since I have quite a bit of SP. Target the back line. Okay. It's going to heal again. Target the back line. I'll target the back line with him. That sounds good. Okay, cool. So I'm just going to use 1 SP here. 1 SP. I'm going to heal. 1 SP. Or sorry, no SP. No SP, no SP, no SP. Okay, cool. Okay. This dungeon is looking pretty problematic so far. So this is the team that you want to be looking out for. The more sword guys you have, the more Varlos you have, the more risky it is. Same thing with Larzul, because Larzul does hit pretty hard. Let's go ahead and take out Larzul first, since he is the weakest link. Make sure we keep those heals up. Take out Larzul again. Keeping up those heals. Target the front. Okay, heal first. Target the front. Heal. Front. Front. Heal. Front. These guys are taking a lot of our SP and a lot of our health. So hopefully the boss is not next. If he is, it's going to be pretty bad for us. And he's next. Let's see if there's any other familiars to farm off of to get some health. And it doesn't look like it. This is looking pretty bad, but let's see if we can do this. Let's try a new strat by taking out the guys up front first. Since our target back doesn't really seem to be doing much, let's take out the guys up front. So I'm going to target the front end. We still have our mount skill, which is great. I'm going to damage back. Okay, so here I'm going to mount skill. It doesn't seem like we can take out the guys up front. The guys up front are surviving. Let's keep trying. Does not seem like we can, though. These guys refuse to die. Okay, Borlin is dead. That is a big problem. Going to minor revive. It doesn't seem like we'll be able to get it in this run. It's one down, but he is the least of our worries. Going to heal them up, which is a bad idea, but there's nothing we can really do. Target, heal, closest, closest. Heal, closest, target, closest, closest. The good thing is now every attack is going to be hitting this guy. So hopefully that will make the difference. I don't believe I have died yet, have I? No, okay. So, ooh, actually, I have. That looks a bit, okay. I've already healed myself, that's what I meant to say. So I need to be really careful. Everyone here seems to have taken a potion already. Going to be chipping away at us for now. But we are chipping away at him as well. My mount skill is already gone, but by the looks of it, since we took out those front guys, it does seem to be making a big difference. We are able to self-sustain quite a bit better. This run is seeming a lot better so far. Oh! That might be the end of us, actually. If we don't get our heals up soon. Okay. And we got him. Awesome, awesome. That was a close one. So you can do this with only tier 6 epics. I really recommend you get the Eye of the Dragon Sword. It is pretty good. That target attack is awesome. Honestly, that target attack is the whole reason we won this dungeon as easy as we did. I did fail the first time, but as you can see, I made no other changes and I just did it again and I was able to continue on through. The only change I really did do was I targeted the front guys before I targeted the guy in the back, only because it seems like since I wasn't able to consistently poke at the guy in the back with Shramps and Borland, I wasn't doing enough damage. So you want to take out the guys up front as fast as possible. So you want to always do closest, or target the closest if it does more damage to take out the guys up front. Just make sure you keep your heals high, and you want to make sure that you use your mount skill if it's a heal when you have the chance. Okay, so before I go ahead and do this last dungeon, I'm going to show you a trick. So pretty much, if you go to PvP or GVG or Expedition, whatever it's going to be, Trials, if you see your rewards, you could see here that this is going to be the tier 6 option, the tier 6 materials. Let's see, PvP, rewards, tier 6 stuff. But here's the tip. It's not really the best thing to do in the earlier tiers or in any tier at all, but it really depends what you're going for. Sometimes when you're doing PvP, the reward will be a pet, let's say a legendary pet, a mythic pet, an epic pet. Let's say you need one, right? What you could do is if you start while you're in tier 6, which I will go ahead and do, if you start while you're in tier 6, your rewards will be in tier 6, even if you go in tier 7. And if you're in tier 7, you will have more stats. And the more stats you have, the more points you will get accumulated when you do defeat an enemy. So I went ahead and I did that. I'm going to also do guild v guild. I do not plan to leave, so yes. I'm going to attack these guys. Now let me go ahead and clear this. I already know how I want my team. Best thing to do is to have a tank up front, a tanker bait in back. And you want to make sure you at least have one DPS. And usually there's different ways of setting it up. GVG is always different. There, you can have all baits. Some people run one bait with all DPS. Some people run all tanks. It really depends on your team synergy, your team comp. Make sure you talk to your guild about it to see what the best layout is. I would always ask whoever the top contributor is or whoever's the strongest in the guild to ask for their opinion on the layout. But if you really need any questions, it's best to talk amongst each other or ask in world chat, because it's always different for everybody. Right now, I'm going to be running a Precunious tank up front, a Perk Warden in back, and I'm going to be running a healer slash DPS as well. Let's go to trials real quick. I want to make sure that I do whatever I can handle. My TS is pretty low. I'm going to do the lowest I can for that. So I don't even know if I can do this. Let's see if I can. This is going to be quite the challenge. Let's go with Borland. Put him in the middle. Alright. Seems like we can auto this. Now, pretty much the whole point of this was to make sure that my rewards were ranked among tier 6 while I'm in tier 7. That way I am stronger and accumulate more points for the tier I am in. So since I will be in tier 7, I will be able to do higher tiers and still benefit from the tier 6 rewards for the people that are stuck in tier 6, which a lot of people do get stuck in tier 6 due to... I forgot his name, the little pink ball that was in the second dungeon, the chewy guy, I forgot his name, that guy. People get stuck there for some reason because he does attack weakest, and some people just can't handle it. But usually the people that are stuck there are the people you're going to be going against on the leaderboard. Some people are campers, and the campers are the problems, but they're not going to be a problem if you're in tier 7 gear while they're in maxed out tier 6 gear, so you'll be fine. The good thing is I'm going to be pretty much speeding on through this as I have been doing, and I'm going to have a lot more TS than the people that are in my tier for the rankings I'm going to be in, so I should be able to place higher as a free-to-play much easier, especially since I'm not trying to focus high placement. The easier, higher placements that are freely given to me are going to benefit me in the long run, which is great. Now, I didn't get to go over Wardy in the last video, or the last few videos, so I'm just going to show you real quick, closest, target, and damage all. Okay, he does not want to die. There you go. We got him. All right. Now that I have done that, I will be placed in tier 6 while being in tier 7. Let's go to quests, and I will show you that it is to find and defeat Mogher. We are going to be getting gems here, which is great. I'm going to go ahead and auto on through since I do have carries. I will see you at the boss. So Mogher is here. He's quite the quiet guy. Your silence proves you are scared. He just finished being quiet, so I'm pretty sure he's scared as well. Now this guy, he does closest enemy and target 1 SP. The target 1 SP is pretty gnarly. He also does closest 2, so there is not a single spot and a weakest 2 SP. He's actually all around pretty solid. He seems like a glass cannon, which is pretty good for us, and he's placed in the front for some reason. You would probably want to target him out if you are having problems. He does pretty much have every spot covered. I say the safest spot you can have anyone at would still probably be the back, only because he has two moves that can target the closest, and one of them is closest too. So your weakest guy will be safest in the back, but then again, you are fighting against Larzel as well, who has a 2 SP attack furthest. And 3 random enemies. I didn't know that was 3 random enemies. That is pretty gnarly. So you gotta be careful with this guy. This guy hits pretty hard. So what I recommend doing is taking out the back end, or the, I mean, honestly, maybe just taking out the boss, because these guys are still pretty weak in comparison to him. These guys have 63 stam compared to 175. So if you can back end target them really quickly without losing anybody, you'd want to do that first. But if not, I highly recommend you take out Mogher first, since he is a problem. I am running with carry, so I'm just going to auto on through. Alright, another bounty completed, and we did just defeat this dungeon. We are finally done with this area. Good riddance, Morgoroth. We are going to have to come back to Farmularius, but that is fine. Now we are in a spot where a lot of players quit the game, because it does get a lot harder from here. New adventures await you in Cambora. You're going to hate Cambora, I promise you all. But trust me, if you listen to me and you follow this tutorial, or this Let's Play actually, you should be doing fine. There's no need to worry about Cambora. You might be stuck here maybe a little longer than usual. If each tier has been taking you between 2 days and, like, let's say a week or two, this one might add a week or two to your time to beat this game. Do not lose faith. Once you pass this part, it will be getting a lot easier. There is another hiccup. There's a few hiccups, but this is probably one of the biggest hiccups in the whole game. Once you pass this, it will be fine, I promise you. But as of right now, you're going to want to mainly focus on Mogher's Catacomb. You are going to want to max this out to heroic and farm it with all of your energy every day until you get the Ularius schematic. And once you get the Ularius schematic, you will be farming everything you need to make him. I believe it's just a bunch of everything that's in his dungeon to make him. He is extremely useful even after this dungeon. He is a deflect tank. If you can make a deflect tank that's not him easier for some reason, by all means, go for it. But you are going to want to make sure you stable him. That way you can stack more deflect pumps on him if you have them, or if you have something with a high base deflect, that is what matters. Deflect tends to be the way they do things here for that one. I don't really know anyone that's done any other method successfully without struggling, so I recommend going for the deflect tank. He is also a pretty good tank to have as a free-to-play. You never know when you need deflect. Later on in the game, you will be needing deflect for certain things, so it's pretty safe to have him. I recommend you farm him. I'm going to show you that you can now do tier 7 for both Nether and Orlag. Let me actually show you the rewards for Tier 7. Here, you could finally get Mythic items. Superstition is a very nice cosmetic. These things aren't worth keeping, but what you want to do when you get a Mythic item, and I cannot stress this enough, I will tell you every time I bring up Mythic items, you want to level it up one time, and then you scrap it. And this is only and only for Mythic items. Mythic items will give you more in return if you scrap a plus one. Sets don't do that, neither do legendaries. So do not worry about the sets or legendaries. Now, this set here, the Hangin' Tato, it's a cool little set. It launches it pretty much has a pet proc. It's pretty cool, but it's not really the greatest set in the world. It's nowhere near it. I highly recommend you don't go for it at all. The Drenith schematic, again, is pretty useful. That is going to be the Mythic Familiar that we are going to hunt down in this Let's Play. One of them, at least. I do plan to make 2 to 3 different Mythic Familiars as a free-to-play, and I will show you how to do that. But right now, the main focus is going to be... Demon is the least important schematic. You don't need it at all, actually. You are going to want Ragnar, Drazig, and Rarzok. So, I can't remember which one out of Ragnar and Rarzok is needed, but I know Drazig is going to be your main DPS fam for a majority of the game. We are going to be getting Zorgim. We're going to need Zorgim for one of these. We're going to need all of these, actually, all these epics. But right now, Omo is the main schematic. So if you have Omo already, Omo will be helping you tremendously. Let's actually go ahead and look at the fusions real quick to see if I have the Omo schematic. If you see this Demon Blood here, yeah, as you can see, this is Omo right here. Yeah, if you have Demon Blood, that shows you that it is a Nether fusion. So here, Omo, you're going to need 10 Demon Blood or Demon Juice, and you're going to need 6 Oppo just to make one. And you're going to be needing to make, I'd say, the same amount as Borland. So if you're going to be making 7 of these, 6 times 7, I think that's 42, you're going to be needing 42 Oppos alone just to max out Omo. So you can see why I said you're going to be farming that one dungeon like crazy. You're going to also need Clavit, I believe, for something. I'm not entirely sure. And you are going to need Zorgim. Now, I already did get a Torlim, and I was able to make one of my Zorgims so I can make a legendary familiar out of it. For right now, I don't have the schematic, which is unfortunate, but it's fine. I'm in no rush to make this guy's legendary form yet. The only legendary form I'm interested in would be Omo's, but for right now, Omo is going to be a healer, I believe. He is a dual strike at 22% familiar. He has decent speed, it's slow stat, decent health, but a lot of damage. He does closest spread heal teammates, which is amazing. Spread heal is awesome. Deals damage to random enemy, which is great because it hits pretty hard. It's unfortunate that it's not a target, but hey, it does a lot of damage. If you get the target that you want hit, it is a lot more damage than a targeting attack would be doing. Dual strike is great. You could possibly proc 2 on that person that you want to destroy. You never know. And closest 2, which is great, because usually if it's a team of 2 or a team of 3 layout, you're going to be trying to attack the front 2 just to get out some of the tanks sometimes, so that's pretty awesome. Problem is, it is a 2 SP. Your main attack is going to be the random and the heal, and of course the closest when you don't have any SP. So he's pretty good. I highly recommend you hard farm him as much as you can, because he is going to be useful. But for right now, Eulerius is the main focus for sure. Now this, anything that involves any materials from the events, I highly recommend against, only because it's really not easy to farm it at all. It only comes around every few months, and yeah, it's just really hard to wait for it. I only have 100 after playing the whole week, and you need to make 6 of these guys, or 7, I'd say 6 because I believe he's a tank. As you can see here, it's just not worth it. It's not at all, because that's a lot of croutons here. I played a lot of regen and I only got 100, which is barely enough to make one. So yeah, anything with an expedition or invasion familiar, I will not be making. There's only one familiar that I might make from expedition, which I will go over once the expedition comes around. But for now, we are just going to be focusing on Omo. A tier list will be coming out soon now that we have passed tier 6, but it is only going to be a tier list that is going to be telling you what fams to get from tier 1 to tier 6. And then after tier 6, I'm going to be doing a tier 7 to tier 8 once I have completed it, tier 7 to tier 8. I know it's a little backwards, but it's easier for me to make it if I've been through the levels and I recap myself, because I haven't been in these tiers in quite a while. So just stay tuned for that one. That video will be coming out soon. I can't really show you Expedition and Invasion, but they pretty much drop similar items that pretty much some of the raid drops. You'll be getting a lot of the similar stuff in the reward table. They also have sets there, I believe. Trials, let's show you the Trials rewards. Let's go to... Oh, since I have not defeated all of the previous dungeons on 3-star, I only have Legendary unlocked. As you can see, I don't have the set Tier 7 unlocked. It's because I need to defeat all of these and make them all 3-stars. So once I do that, it will unlock the Trials. I might actually show you that real quick before I hop off. But first, let's go to Raid, and you will see here that we have the Hail of a Mystique, which is cool. I really like this raid. It has a pretty nice set. I mean, you're not going to use it, but it's a pretty nice set. I've always liked this set. I don't know why, I've just liked it. It's called Maru, the Maru set. It's a healer set. Again, healers are out of meta. They're never in meta, unfortunately. But it does have a pretty good overhealing converts to shields ability for a 3-piece bonus, which is nice. But again, I strongly advise against making these sets. They are not worth making at all. The Mythic Familiars are not worth making at all. Wall Ogder's good, but he's just too expensive. And for this Let's Play, we are not going down the Orlag path. We are going down the Nether path. Mythic Curios, again, are useful. This is a Mythic... people call it the Pews. They're Pews. They're lasers. This is a Mythic Pew. I highly recommend against leveling this up. You're only going to level it up once and scrap it immediately, because having anything that is not an epic main hand for the beginning of the game is a huge mistake. It is just not useful. It's not viable. It only has 3 ricochet chance, and it is the most expensive thing you can level up aside from an ancient weapon, which pretty much is not going to be obtainable at all in this Let's Play. Most ancient weapons in the game are pretty useless. The only good one is probably Polychromatic Blaster for a DPS setup, and even then it's not that useful. So I highly recommend against most ancients. There's only one really good ancient in the game that I recommend everyone get. I'm not sure if I'm going to squeeze that into the Let's Play. If you want me to, I can try, but I promise you it's going to be quite the challenge. But as of right now, it is not on the roadmap. But anyways, Decay here is a Mythic Ring. 5% chance for healing skills received to be twice as effective. That is not that useful. Again, healing is pretty out of meta. This whole thing is all useless. You're just going to be focusing on all epics, and I believe this is the tier where you have to have at least 1 or 2 legendaries. So we're going to be replacing every piece of our gear for sure, and we are going to try to get at least 1 legendary. So yeah, we're going to go through this raid real quick. Of course, you're going to want to always do heroic with the 400% item find. Okay. Same layout as always for now, and we're gonna go ahead and check out these new familiars. So here are 3 new familiars. We have this guy up front, which is J317 or -17. He does closest, drain health from all, which is pretty weak. A drain is usually the weakest move in the game. Spread heal teammates, which is unfortunate. He's a healer and weakest, but he is very slow, so you don't have to worry about him too much. He heals, so it's kind of annoying. We have a closest, furthest, and heals target teammate. And I think these guys are the damage dealers. Yeah, closest and target. So their target 1 SP is annoying. They have a lot of speed. They have damage to all enemies, which is pretty devastating in some circumstances. And random, which is very scary if it hits the wrong guy. So you're going to want to take out duo bombs as much as you can. Like, if you can take out duo bombs, take them out. Everyone else is pretty easy in the raid. And I'm only saying this if you don't have significantly great carries, like greater carries than like the average person. Like if you have no carries that are above like tier 8, then you might struggle in this raid, honestly. It's pretty easy, again, to get carries. Just ask in world chat or just try to randomly add someone. I really highly recommend it against randomly adding. I always like it when people ask me for a friend slot. Usually when people send me a request, I don't know, it seems kind of rude. So it's best to just ask. But as of right now, we're just going to go ahead and go on by. This guy just makes a bunch of noises. Okay, so, well, I guess I'll show you all at the familiar tab, since he just got instantly annihilated and I didn't have any time to stop him from getting destroyed. Okay, so far nothing good for the loot recap. Again, epics from the previous tier maxed out have more than a maxed out current tier if you're in the tier after the last tier. I highly recommend just keeping your epics until you find new ones. Let's go ahead and check out that familiar's moveset. Let's go to familiars. He is a legendary, so he will be more towards the bottom. He should be right here. Yes. Okay, so he does closest. Okay, furthest enemy and two random. Now that's pretty bad. And damage to all enemies. He also does the weakest with 2 SP and spread heal teammates. He's pretty slow. He's really nothing to worry about. Unless you have someone really weak in the back end, I recommend you take him out. But that's why I recommend putting one tank front and one back with the bait second, and then 2 DPS, or you and a DPS in the fourth and third slot. So again, dual bombs is scarier. You want to take out dual bombs and then you can target this guy if dual bombs is in your group. If not, then you can take him out first. Pretty easy. Now I'm going to go ahead and show you real quick that once we get all of these done, I'm gonna go ahead and fast forward through all of them, that we will be unlocking the set items for tier 7 trials and gauntlet. The only reason why I'm recommending that we do this is because if you do get a mythic or set, you can scrap them and get more materials than just scrapping legendaries. So you are going to want to make sure that you have it unlocked and farm those if you are strong enough to farm them. Okay, as you can see here, now that we are done with all three of the dungeons, you will be unlocking this one that says the fourth dungeon, the D4, as people call it on Bit Heroes. Clear the dungeon of all enemies. Before I do that, I'm going to go ahead and see if I unlock these sets. As you can see here, now that I have defeated the first three dungeons of the past tier, I now have the set versions available. So I'm just going to just select it so you can see the rewards. Here you get consumption and you also get night visage as your mythics. Now these both look very, very cool, but again, they are not worth keeping. You are going to level it by one and then scrap it for the mythics, of course. As I said before, the mithril are pretty good. If you get them, that's great. You're not going to be hunting them. You will be acquiring plenty of them in your gameplays. You will be aiming for these epics. Now again, you will want to save every weapon type in tier 7, that way you can play and experiment with them. If you have like three different types and they're all epic, save them all. Trust me, they're worth saving. You never know, like just like for example the last flag I did, the axe wasn't useful but the sword was. If I had only had the axe, I would have been in a lot of trouble and I would not have been able to pass that, I don't think. So here you're going to just be aiming for the legendaries and epics. You're mainly going to only want one legendary and maxing out that one legendary. You are not going to want more than one. If you really cannot defeat it with one, again, it cannot be your main hand. Make sure you do not use a legendary main hand. Do not use a legendary main hand. I cannot stress that enough. Do not. Then you will try to level up a second one or try to get a stronger mount if you do have the guts to get a stronger mount. Now, the way people usually go is they will go from the green that they give you for free, they will go to a rare mount, and then they will skip the epic mount. I highly recommend you skip the epic mount completely The epic mount is a complete waste of time and a complete waste of mount guts. So I'm going to go to the mounts really quick. Now mounts here, as you can see, I can already make an epic, but I don't want an epic. Epic is cool and all, but if you can skip straight to the legendary, you can see here that you can level up 4 times. That's going to give you more total stats in the end. Not to mention, it's pretty much an endgame mount. It's not the most end of game mounts, because there are mythic mounts, but it is a mount that you are going to need regardless. Because to make the mythic mount, you are going to be needing to scrap legendary mounts to get some of the material. Just to make the mounts, I believe. So for right now, you are going to be skipping the epic mount entirely and going straight to the legendary. Which is why I have been hovering around the rare mount that I've been using, as you see here. I still have my rare mount, and I am currently in tier 7. Yeah, it just pretty much has evade chance. It's pretty good, but it's not the greatest. Evade is pretty bad early game, but later game, evade is pretty nice. Evade will come in clutch, but for now, it's not really the greatest. So pretty much, that's pretty much going to be it for the episode. There's really nothing else to go over. The next episode, we're going to be going through Cambora. Cambora is, again, a huge problem, so hopefully we can do it in one run. We'll try it out next time for sure, but as of right now, everything seems to be completed. You're going to want to work on getting the familiars from Mogher's Catacomb, and you want to get the Ullarius schematic. Again, that is your main focus, is making the maxed out Ullarius. You're going to want to make 6 of him, maybe even 7 of him. Running 7 of him is usually which is 7, is pretty much the strat for getting past the hardest part in Cambora. You're going to want to max him out, and if you max him out and you still haven't gotten enough like gear, like total stats, to pass the next area for some reason, then you want to start farming Uzmire afterwards. But only after you have a maxed out Ullarius crafted. You want to max him out for sure. You don't want to do anything else. You want to max him out. So other than that, that is all you're going to be focusing. Your raid, you will be running a lot of this raid here, which is going to be a hail of a mistake. So yeah, pretty much just run what you can, your regen, as much as you can. Try to get all epics, and if you cannot pass it with all epics, make sure you have legendary that you can max out on standby. Just keep scrapping them all until you get, I mean, you can honestly get anything you want except the main hand. You're going to want to keep the main hand open so you can have an offhand, a helm, a body, a neck, or a ring. And you also want to try to get a legendary mount. If you have a legendary mount or enough to get a legendary mount, or you just want to buy one in the shop for gems, let's say you saved up your gems, I highly recommend it. But as of right now, I'm going to be sticking with this rare mount, since I am going to be purchasing other things with my gems. For now, I am saving them for accessories, pets, and brain augments, since brain augments are pretty necessary to progress in this game pretty easily. So I'm lucky enough to have gotten an epic one for my tank. I need a better one for my DPS/healer now, but as of right now, I think my weakest game is probably my pet and accessory. So that's going to be next on my gems list, since I can just easily craft my own legendary mount just by playing the game. So everything's going to be fine in that aspect. You're not going to want to scrap your rare if you do get a legendary. You're going to want to scrap it once you max out your legendary, or get it past the total stats that your rare gives you, or your common or epic, whatever you currently have. You're going to want to make sure your legendary has more stats than the previous one that you were using before you equip it. Otherwise, it is a total waste. Trust me, it is not worth putting on. But yeah, that's going to be the end of the episode, guys. I really, really appreciate all the feedback y'all give me. I love being able to help you guys. Again, if you're a veteran player and you're just coming to just support or just to watch something, please help out the guys in the comment section. I get a lot of questions there sometimes, and sometimes I don't see them, or I just don't know the answer. Or maybe I'm busy working. If you see them and you have time to give them tips and advice, please do so. I know they appreciate it. I know I do. And yeah, let's try to keep this community strong. Again, this is World Eater. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'll see you in the next one, guys. Peace.